Welcome to Critical Thought TV. I'm your host, Stuart Dambrot. Today we're here with great anticipation speaking with Lina Srivastava, a transmedia activist and actual coiner of the phrase. She's also a self-described, and this is unusual for our audience, a non-futurist and a non-techno-optimist. Her focus is more on technologies that enhance rather than replace human interaction. Welcome to the show.
Thank you so much for having me.
It's my pleasure. I think the best thing for us to do, because some of the audience may not be familiar with transmedia and transmedia activism, is to start with an introduction, an overview, if you will, of transmedia.
Sure.
And when we had spoken earlier, you had mentioned that there are different views and different ways of interpreting the term. So I'll leave it to you to explain that, please.
Sure. Transmedia is basically a construct. It's a design construct that describes a form of storytelling. It's a fairly old term. It's the first mention that I saw of it was about 40 years ago. But it's really been taken, you know, sort of to the world by someone named Professor Henry Jenkins, who was first with the MIT Media Lab and now is with USC Annenberg, I believe. And he sort of took this, he took the concept, and he has built an entire field out of it, which is really pretty amazing. Transmedia, we don't have an accepted definition of it yet, but what it is basically, it's taking a story property, and extending it over a number of different platforms through coordination, through a system of architecture, and making sure that you create a number of entry points into the core story, into the story universe, for your audience and participants to come in and help you build that world. So one of the earliest examples that he gave was something like The Matrix, for example. Okay, so you have, you know, sort of the three film properties, which are the core story of Neo and, you know, sort of the world and the world of The Matrix and breaking down that world. That then extended over blogs and graphic novels and comics and even action figures and such. So that's one way of thinking about a story universe and extending it through participation with your audience. Okay, I started looking at this concept about 4 years ago because I discovered design and social innovation and transmedia all at the same time. And I was very interested in looking at how you increase participation in social action, in social change. And transmedia, to me, it was sort of a revelation in terms of how you could use story as a predicate for a movement or as a predicate for social change, and how you extend that story and get more people participating in social action using entry points into a core story, which in my case, when I think of transmedia and transmedia activism, it's actually your core story is mirrors your issue or the change or the goal that you're aiming for.
So that raises two questions, and we had talked a little bit about this previously. First is the relationship between cross-platform and transmedia. It seems, and I could be wrong about this, but it occurred to me while you were defining it that there's even the echo of the roots of hyperlinking and the use of hypertext in conveying a particular set of pieces of related content.
Sure.
But then also in relation to cross-platform in terms of different infrastructures and different types of creative media channels. That's one question I have, and then I'll get to the second
one. Transmedia and cross-platform are extremely closely aligned. Again, this is not necessarily an accepted definition, in terms of like industry-wide accepted, but the way I make the distinction between transmedia and, say, cross-media or cross-platform is the participatory element, where so your audience is becoming your set of authors as well. There's a little bit of a breakdown of that distinction. And it's also, there's a stewardship element to it. There's an intentionality to transmedia. And that is that is an element that isn't necessarily that accepted yet. And then there's decentralization, right? So you're looking at a number of different authors who are formerly your audience coming in and taking your story and helping you extend it out into different platforms. So cross-platform is more sort of just taking your content and spreading it over a number of different platforms. Right. Transmedia has those additional elements of participation, decentralization, and stewardship.
So then this was not the second question I referred to previously, so
okay.
I'm switching gears a little bit, but it occurred to me to ask, then, is it always an issue that is pre-existing, or does sometimes, in other words, to be stewarded, there has to be some type of formal identification of a core issue for people to gather around and participate in communicating about. Is it ever the case that something spontaneously arises and then, in fact, the issue is more narrowly identified and stewarded? Could that be a possibility?
That could be a possibility. At the moment, I'm sort of hard-pressed to think of an example. In social action particularly, is that what you're talking about?
Not necessarily only social action, but whatever you would like to answer in any way.
So when I think about how you create a transmedia platform, the first thing that you do is you identify your core story.
All right, very good.
Right? Okay. So you could feasibly do that out of a set of assets that already exist, right?
I see.
For sure. So think about something like, I mean, this is probably not the right example, but let's go with it for a little while. Think about The Inconvenient Truth.
Right.
So Al Gore had a lecture that he had been sort of working on for 30 years that he then created a set of slides around, you know, after the 2000, mm-hmm. not defeat, but whatever it is, the 2000 debacle.
I was going to say embarrassment.
The embarrassment. Yeah. So he had been working on the issue of climate change for a very long time and gathered a number of assets around this. Then he had a set of slides that came out of that. Okay, so that's not particularly a transmedia effort. However, a producer came in and took a look at these slides and said, we can amplify this. We can amplify your story.
Oh, I see.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
So these are existing assets that that were taken and then turned into a number of different assets that are still, you know, the last asset that was released was a year ago, Choice ebook, which is, mm-hmm. you know, sort of this beautiful set, this beautiful ebook, an app that was created around. Mm-hmm. And it's this sort of 30-35 year effort that he's been using media around. So I, you know, yes, I guess your answer to your question is yes.
I see how that would work then, because and it satisfies your criteria, which we'll get to shortly. Yeah. That it not everyone. Some people simply are engaged in the content and talk about it, but mm-hmm. it motivated a number of people, anywhere from Greenpeace at one end all the way down to just local actions to become more involved in conservation and climate change and other ecologically related actions.
Yeah.
Very good. Perhaps you could just go very quickly over a few of the terms that people may not have heard. And there are four of them. Co-design, mm-hmm. co-creation, co-evolution, and co-production.
Sure. Okay, so they're all related terms. They all, at the root, talk to collaboration. So co-creation, I usually use that in terms of a network.
Okay.
So what you're doing is you're creating a network of people that cross disciplines, cross sort of industry silos, that cross borders, who come together and create a network, right, to create assets and discussion around a particular issue.
So it focuses largely on the narrative itself.
Yes, exactly. Okay. Co-production then goes from there and takes the narrative and actually it renders it. Right? So something like there's a really interesting case study. It's a film called Iron Sky. It's not a social issue at all. It's by a Finnish man named Timo Varensola, who created the most successful Finnish movie in history just this past February. And what he did was he co-created the entire platform with his fans. Okay, so it was co-funded, co-investment. Co-production and sort of co-creation. He was asking people to help research, he was asking people to help produce assets, he was asking people to come in and invest together. There's a whole film about this
that
he made.
Yeah.
It's amazing. So sort of looking at these different, so co-creation leads to co-production, right? Which then also, you know, looks, you can then go to co-design, co-designing your platform off of those assets.
Very good.
But it's all collaborative.
Very, very good. Perhaps we could just close this introduction by pointing out some of the other ways. For example, with the relationship, for example, of crowdsourcing to transmedia might be interesting, because some people who are watching may be thinking about crowdsourcing, because it is reminiscent of that. And perhaps if you could compare the two.
Sure. Crowdsourcing is it's a little more limited than transmedia. Again, transmedia is a deliberate exercise, the design. right? There's a design construct to it. Crowdsourcing, you're really trying to get your crowd to give you something.
I see.
Right. So you might be crowdsourcing concepts or crowdsourcing money or crowdsourcing, you know, things. But it's not necessarily taking a narrative and spreading it. It's not taking a core story and spreading it over a number of different platforms. So crowdsourcing is still, to me, crowdsourcing is still fairly unidirectional, and it's not participatory in the same way, and it's not about spreading or co-creating a narrative.
I see. So then the filmmaker we just discussed, the Finnish filmmaker, used crowdsourcing techniques to build his infrastructure, but then extended it into a transmedia infrastructure by by distributing it outward.
Yeah. Whether Iron Sky is actually a transmedia effort is a question that remains to be seen, right? It was transmedia in the input, not necessarily the output, because what it created was one single film to this point.
I see. And if he had done some of the things that you've talked about in having ancillary and multiple expressions and venues for communicating the value proposition of that content, then it would be a transmedia
a full
property.
On the output side, he may still do that, but it doesn't. I still think it's transmedia because there's a transmedia effort on the input side.
Very good.
To make this film.
Thank you so much.
Sure.